प्लीज डू थ्री मंत्र कश्यप भाई प्लीज फॉलो.
नमो वीतरागाय
नमो वीतरागाय
नमो अरिहंताणं
नमो अरिहंताणं
नमो सिद्धाणं
नमो सिद्धाणं
नमो आयरियाणं
नमो आयरियाणं
नमो वज्जायाणं
नमो वज्जायाणं
नमो लोए सवसाहुणं
नमो लोए सवसाहुणं
ऐसो पंचन मुक्कारो
ऐसो पंचन मुक्कारो
सव पाव पनासनो
सव पाव पनासनो
मंगलानं च सवेसिं
मंगलानं च सवेसिं
परमं हवै मंगलम
परमं हवै मंगलम
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमः शिवाय
ओम नमः शिवाय
जय सच्चिदानंद
जय सच्चिदानंद.
Jai Satyananda Mahatmas, welcome to the English version of the satsang. There's no question, so I'll start with the question. Next week, we have 5 days of great religious festivals. So we understand all the rituals and we go through that. Can you explain the spiritual significance for us for those 5 days?
Well, historically, Diwali is associated with Ram returning to Ayodhya after victory over Ravana. And recent, that is during the Ram's time, and the recent is, it is associated with the Lord Mahavira attaining salvation or moksha. He attained salvation on the Diwali day. So it is also celebrated as a festival of lights, you know. These are two basic significances of the Diwali. Then you have the New Year following it and Bhai Bij. So the brother and sister, they meet and they, you know, greet and things like that. Uske pehle, the year, day before that is Kali Chaudas. It's a dark day, you can say. The day when the Lord is going to attain salvation. So Keval Gnani Tirthankar is going to, not going to remain in the mortal frame. And the one before that, Dhanteras. So typically Dhanteras people feel okay, on that day, they have to cleanse or wash dhan, yeah, wealth, money. So on a symbolic level, they do some pujas and, you know, wash some coins, currency coins, rupees coins. Truly speaking, Dhanteras was associated with using judiciously our wealth or doing charity. Using wealth for the welfare of others, putting wealth to good use. Dhan teras, yani dhan ko dhona, to cleanse wealth or money, really meant was putting it to good use or spending it for charity for the welfare of someone. So on that day, very people really do dhan teras. Traders do Lakshmi Pujan, where they do pujan for the goddess Lakshmi as well as their books of accounts. I remember my aunt and uncle who religiously do that, and it was a big occasion. And all the books, physically manual books, were written. Now that computerization has come in, but before that, they would really buy those books and then they would really do tilak and swastik and all that stuff, you know. It was a ritual. Which, and after the ritual, then they would celebrate it with bursting of firecrackers and distribution of meats. The family would be gathering over there, men and women and everybody. So Lakshmi Pujan, Dhanteras, Kali Chaudas, Vastu Varas New Year. So this is that sequence of the same.
What is the spiritual connotation of Kali Chaudas for us?
For us, if you really ask me, na Dada, little that I know of. Dada, for us, the Vastu Varas of the New Year was of immense significance. Dada said that on this day, I am in my full form. That is, I am in total Shuddhatma state. And if you do the darshan of me at that day, you get the darshan of the full Dada Bhagwan or the full enlightened state. On that day, he would not get involved in Vyavhar. Please come here, do vidhi, how are you, and things like that. He would be in a total enlightened state, that is, in oneness with the inner Dada Bhagwan. And seeing a body frame, Jnani Purush, who is in that state of being, is a very, very auspicious thing. So for us, now, although he's not there, we can make use of that significance. We can decide to remain in our pure soul awareness, in the Shuddhatma awareness throughout that day. So we remain in constant touch with our inner Radha Bhagwan or inner Shuddhatma Bhagwan, pure soul, and remain of awareness or in Jagrati throughout that day. We can get mileage or benefit of that day in the true sense as a Mahatma. As a Mahatma, we can use that, okay, today I'll remain throughout the day in Shuddhupyo or pure awareness state. And preferably being an auspicious thing. Guru Purnima, this was the auspicious day. So we should preferably get up early in the morning and do some prayers, some special pratigaman or some special asking of strength, what we are missing in our path to moksha. Because although Dada Bhagwan is not there in his body form, but his divine grace is operating. And if you make use of this day, early in the morning, you see, it's like joining ourselves or connecting ourselves to Dada Bhagwan or Dada Bhagwan's divine grace. It's of immense benefit. Auspicious day is an auspicious time, have their significance. It is an opportunity to be graced. It is an opportunity to be graced with divine blessings. So as a Mahatma, we should make use of that, getting up early in the morning and do something apart from the normal vidhis, and apart from that. That would be significant for us. And we pray that our light, our inner light, our spiritual light, or our Jagrati or awareness of Shuddhatma enhances. We pray for that. Jagrati or awareness increases so that we may progress on our moksha marga. So this is the little significance I would attach with Diwali and New Year Day as a Mahatma. Others, though, relative viewpoint, Dhanteras and all the rituals are there. So those who are businessmen and all, they may do it. But the relative significance is there. Spiritually, this is all that comes to my mind at the moment. Okay,
very good. We have a question from the audience, Dipalji.
Yeah, Dr. Kashyapji and Umesh Bhai, we will just take the newcomer's question. So, and then we will take up yours, please. Kanu Bhai V. His name is Kanuba. I was introduced yesterday. And he has a question, Pulina Anandji. He's asking that how can one start the learning process of Dada Bhagwan science while managing a full-time job and family duties?
Okay, for your while information, Pulitanji, Kanuba Varodarya, he just moved to Anand Vihar. He is not a Mahatma. and he's learning this process. So that is a question.
Okay.
And then Dr. Kashyapai, Umesh Bhai will take questions after that.
Okay. Welcome, Kanu Bhai, to this Akram Vignan Satsang. This is a science, a spiritual science, or an inner science. Inner science means inner happiness and the science of who we truly are, that we are the true, pure soul, and the name is given to the body. Okay. So understanding this part is the essence of this Akram Vignan or the spiritual science. And this science is specially meant for people, as you mentioned. It is specially meant for householders who have family and job duties to do, at the same time be spiritually active. Now, spirituality, you know, if you really ask me, is remaining in the spirit or remaining in the self or remaining in the soul. And it is not does not carry rituals as such. Religion is, you know, is a set of do's and don'ts. Religion is set of practices, worshipping people, idol, etc. So that the human life is a good, you lead a good human life. Whereas the spiritual science, the one that we are talking of, is understanding what is happening to our mind, body, and speech, what we call as prakriti, and why it is happening and how to tackle it. So it is really helpful for a householder like you, you know. Essentially, in simple terms, first thing is to develop an inner desire or inner intent of realizing the pure soul. That is number one. Till you attain your self-realization. I'm answering, how do you benefit from it? The second thing is, we have to also nourish a desire that we will not hurt anybody by our mind, speech, or actions. That is by our thoughts, by our speech, or by actions. This is to just have an inner intent or desire. It may not reflect into actions. Your actions may be opposite to that, but you desire. It is your opinion that I don't want to hurt anybody, any living being, but my mind, speech, and body. So this is the basis, a relative basis of spiritual science, and typically all religions advocate this. Every religion advocates non-violence or non-hurting to fellow creatures. But here, Dada Bhagwan has not laid emphasis on the action part of it, or the you know, what can be seen in terms of your words, that is your speech or your actions. But Dada says, have the inner desire, the bhav or inner intent. Your opinion is not to hurt. Your actions may not follow suit, because actions are different from your inner intent. What you are going to think, or what thoughts that will come to you today, the speech that you may speak, and the actions that you will do at home or at work, they are all pre-decided. They have all come, you know, based on the karmas that you have charged in the previous birth. This is going to be a discharge or an effect playing out of the karmas. So that we don't have much control on. Those will flow. But the pushad that is in our hands, the independent pushad that is in our hands, is while that is coming out, while thoughts are erupting, while speech is playing out, while actions are being done, whether to be in favor or against that is the pushad that we have in our hands at the mind level, inner bhav level. That is, you get angry. Whether, because sometimes someone has done something wrong and you are upset, you get angry. For example, there you can decide, good, unless I scold him, unless I get upset, that man will not going to improve. That is one opinion. And the other opinion is, I regret. I feel bad. Oh, I should have not done this. It's very wrong. So although anger may erupt, but whether to be in favor or against it is our purushartha that is there in our hands now, today. This inner science is the science of inner opinions, inner intents today. That is the purushartha today. So Dada Bhagwan has laid a lot of emphasis on what is happening inside now rather than on the external actions or behaviors that are happening now. So these external things are a result, and what we are doing inside is the cause. So Dada says you cannot change the result, but you can change the cause. So as a householder, to answer your question, while you are doing your family duties as well as your professional life, personal life and professional life, to remain equanimous, not to hurt anybody, is your desire. And in case you happen to hurt anybody in the heat of the moment, repent, apologize within. Within yourself, you must say a small apology prayer, what we call as pratikramana, where we pray and confess our sins before some whatever God we believe in, resolve and then repent for it, say I'm very sorry, and finally resolve not to repeat again. I'm just summarizing what it is, but basically this pratikramana apology prayer is the remedy to whatever behavior that takes place which is against what we have decided today. Morning I have decided not to hurt anybody, but during the day I happen to hurt, so what to do? So there the corrective action is, or the remedial action is, cleanse in the sense apologize within. It'll get cleansed within you. It'll also get cleansed from the other person's mind, the opposite person on whom you happen to be a little aggressive. It'll also get erased from his mind, and he will not have any grudge against you. It's a very scientific thing, and it's a wonderful thing. So we will not carry unwanted garbage in our mind for other person's action, neither will he have a grudge against us for our actions, you know, which have not been suited, which he has not found suitable. So the essence of the science is the inner intent to find out who we are, because all of us seek happiness. You see, the bottom line of any spirituality is permanent happiness. All living beings seek happiness, but they do not know where permanent happiness is, so they seek happiness in the temporary things, the happiness from the five senses and happiness from material gratification or material possessions. That is a worldly viewpoint, nothing wrong. But those are all temporary. So Dada Bhagwan says, you should desire for permanent happiness, number one. Number two, you should desire for happiness that is independent. Today, whatever happiness we have is dependent on the eyes and on the body. You know, if your eyes are good, you'll enjoy a good movie. If your health is good, you'll enjoy a sweet. If your health is good, you'll enjoy an outing or a vacation. So it's dependent on the body. All this happiness. Thirdly, whatever so-called happiness that we are indulging in, the more we do it, will our happiness increase? For example, if you're watching a movie, will you, for a three-hour movie, and if you watch, say, for 24 hours, will your happiness multiply 8 times? If you like some particular sweetmeat, you take it today. If you take it for 15 days, 20 days, will your happiness multiply? You will not. You will get fed up with it. So that is not true happiness. The sweetmeat, there is no happiness in it. There is no happiness in the movie. It is your imposed happiness. Because you like it, you feel it's, you're happy. For others who don't like it, it's not happiness. So these materialistic things per se do not give happiness. These materialist things are not a source of happiness. They are temporary happiness. And everybody wants permanent happiness. So Dada Bhagwan says, seek permanent happiness, number one. Seek permanent happiness, which is independent of the body. That is in your true self or in your soul. Your soul is a source of permanent happiness because soul itself is permanent. Body is temporary, soul is permanent. So if you, and the property, happiness is one of the intrinsic properties of the pure soul. If I am able to experience it, experience the pure soul, I'll be able to experience the pure happiness or the permanent happiness, you know, what we also call as bliss or ananda. So the inner intent that I want to know, that my inner intent that I want to experience my permanent happiness, which is within me, I want to experience my true self, the pure soul, and in the worldly dealings, personal or professional, I do not want to hurt any living being. And in case you happen to hurt, you apologize and cleanse it. So this is the summary for a beginner, that he can start from here. Then there are various other aspects where he will try to understand what are the principles of nature? What are the rules of nature? And by violating those rules of nature, how a human being attracts punishment or discomfort or unhappiness. Like one should not take anything which does not rightfully belong to us. For example, stealing, bribery, etc. And if you hurt anybody, you will get hurt in return. So there are some few rules of nature, which if we violate, we will invite unhappiness. And if we practice, are aligned with them, we will not be the same. So there are some rules of nature. Further ahead, there will be some rules of good human living. There are some principles which, as a human being, if you follow, purely from the relative living, nothing to do with spirituality or nothing to do with salvation or moksha. If you practice or are aware of those rules, then we can also lead a good human life. One of them being that, as far as possible, oblige others by mind, by speech, or by actions. Obliging others, or having an attitude of obliging others, is one of the key principles of happiness. In the relative world, or in the world that we are in, true source of happiness is in giving happiness to others. And that is selfless happiness without expecting anything in return. Without expecting anything in return is the happiness, you know. So this is one of the principles of relative or happy living. So I've very briefly given you some guidelines on how you can take benefit of this spiritual science, or the Akram Vignan, selfless science as we call it, more as and when we proceed ahead. Jai Satyanarayan.
Karubhai, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you very much. Yeah, it gives me a good foundation. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Tidani. Kashyap Bhai?
Yes, everyone, Jai Satchidananda. I have sent Pakananji one poster. Can you please take it out? It is in Hindi, but I will tell what it is. It is about the importance of temples. So Dadaji says that what Mahavir Bhagwan says, last few lines, that when questioner is asking that why these people do not get benefit from the darshan, of the God, from seeing the God. So Mahavir Bhagwan says that when they also have they have also see photo of the sandals, you know, and their shops. This I want to understand. Please explain.
You can quickly read through, it will be better.
हाँ प्रश्न करता, यदि जिनालय नहीं होते, मंदिर नहीं होते, तो फिर जिस प्रकार हमारे लिए दादाश्री प्रकट हुए हैं, उस प्रकार से उनके लिए कोई ना कोई प्रकट हुआ होता ना। दादाश्री वो तो ठीक है, वो तो एक प्रकार का विकल्प है, ऐसा हुआ है, ऐसा नहीं होता तो दूसरा कोई उपाय तो होता ना, दूसरा कुछ ना कुछ मिल जाता। परंतु इन मंदिरों का उपाय बहुत ही अच्छा है, हिंदुस्तान का यह सबसे बड़ा साइंस है, यह सबसे अच्छी परोक्ष भक्ति है। परंतु यदि समझे तो, अभी तो जिनालय में जाते समय मैं महावीर भगवान से पूछता हूँ कि ये सब लोग आपके इतने अधिक दर्शन करते हैं, वो भी इतनी सारी अड़चने क्यों आती है? तब महावीर भगवान क्या कहते हैं, ये लोग दर्शन करते समय मेरा फोटो लेते हैं, बाहर उनके जूते रखे उनका फोटो लेते हैं, और साथ साथ दुकान का भी फोटो लेते हैं, इसलिए ऐसा होता है। अब कोई जूते ले जाए उसका भी फोटो लेते हैं। अकम हाँ, सो आपका योर क्वेश्चन इज के व्हाट इज दादा भगवान ट्राइंग टू से इन दिस?
या द लास्ट फ्यू लाइंस दैट अबाउट द फोटो ऑफ
हाँ So all that Dada Bhagwan is saying is, okay, although he is in front of the idol of the Lord, although he is bowing his head and hands folded, but his chitta is going at two places, one in front of the Lord and one in front of the one at the juta, in the sandals. In the sense, he is anxious. He is anxious that I hope someone doesn't steal away my chappals or sandals. He's also anxious about something at the shop. I hope these things go well at the shop. That means his attention is divided between the three. Lord Mahavir says, you have come to me. If you do my darshan with full attention over here in the present, then you will get the benefit of me. Benefit of me in the sense, he is the epitome of vidrakta, equanimity. You know, no rag, no dvesh, no abhorrence, no attraction. So if you bow to a person, the fully enlightened person, although he is not present, but with that in mind, you will you'll be led towards equanimity, towards vidrakta.
So how the obstacles come arise due to the chit being in sandals and shop, that please explain that.
So when you are also anxious about your shop or sandals, that means you are anxious about materialistic things. Mm-hmm. You still have raga on your materialistic things. You still have raga on worldly belongings.
Yes.
You want to be free from the world. You want to attain moksha or salvation. And you are also on one hand attached to materialist things. So on one hand, you pray to God that I want to attain moksha. And other hand, you also say, no, I want to take care of my sandals and my materialistic things. So that becomes an obstacle, because you are also interested in materialistic things. So if you are interested in materialistic things, obviously that's going to hook you and not allow you to be free and attain salvation. But to be salvation, you have to be totally unhooked from all materialistic things. It's like the anchor of ship, you know.
If the ship the is anchor, obstacles here are worldly or spiritual. Archane, which is saying that the obstacles are worldly or
worldly. If you're doing darshan of an enlightened being who has attained salvation and is showing the path of salvation, so rather than being fully dedicated on that side, you are also interested in not being salvation. You are also interested in remaining in this worldly life, you see. So that's why it's an obstacle. You know, it's like saying, I want to go to Delhi, and at the same time, no, I can't leave my home here. What will happen to my family? So if you're saying, I want to be at home, then you can't go to Delhi. It's like that.
So the obstacles will be means coming in worldly affairs or in attaining moksha.
Obstacles in attaining moksha.
And in worldly affairs, there will be obstacles when the state of mind is like that attention is divided.
Maybe, may not be. Obstacles in worldly is a result of papa or doing mistakes or committing sins.
Okay.
So that is a different, the causes for that are different.
This obstacle is spiritual in context. Got it. Thank you very much. Jai Sachidananda. Swamiji Pranam. Jai Sachidananda. Swamiji, when we say ki nishche drishti se aur vyavhar drishti se, so I would request you to break up the word nishche and drishti and explain nishche and drishti, because for nishche, my understanding is only irrevocable conviction. But I need to understand better.
No. Yeah, you see, the word nishche is used with two ways.
Ji.
Word nishche is used two ways. Nishche is one connotation of nishche is from decision.
Okay.
And that I nishche karta hu, I decide that I will do this.
Ji.
That's a form of resolution.
Okay.
And the other meaning of Nischa is vis-a-vis soul, Atma. So Nischa Drashti and Vyavahar Drashti is that way is like that, you know. Vyavahar Drashti means the relative viewpoint. From the relative viewpoint, I am the name bearer, or whatever I am doing is in the relative, really, world. And Nischa Drashti means from the real viewpoint, from the Atma or soul viewpoint, I am the pure soul.
Okay, so here Nischa means real. Nischa is real. Equal to real. Am I right?
Nischa is equal to real viewpoint, and that is Vyavahar is equal to relative viewpoint.
Relative viewpoint. Okay, very clear. This is very clear, Swamiji. Thank you. There's. Do I have permission to ask another one?
Yes. Go ahead. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Pranam Rajnikanth ji. Swamiji, I will. Is Bhokta Bhav the projection of Karta Bhav?
Karta Bhav is the seed. So the result is Bhokta Bhav.
So when we say projection, it is the cause effect relationship we are talking about?
Cause and effect relationship. Exactly. Okay. It is the cause and effect. Yeah. The cause, Karta Bhav is the cause part of it, and Bhokta Bhav is the effect part of it. If I
want,
the cause, I want to have a lavish lifestyle, with high वो डाला है तो भुक्ता भाव में खाते के मजा करूंगा. I will have a lavish lifestyle.
Okay. But in the general usage of the word, the connotation of projection is that something seems to be there, but it is actually not there. So when we say that Bhokta Bhav is the projection of Karta Bhav, we are not using that connotation of projection. Am I correct? Usually when we say project, like the projector is projecting a film. So there is a projection of the film on the screen. So there is a film there, but yet it is not really there, but it appears to be there. So that is the usual connotation we take for projection.
No. That is not the
connotation. This is not. Okay.
Okay. What meaning you are putting is, it is an illusion.
Yes. Very right. Very right.
Projection is different from illusion.
Yes.
When you talk of projection, say the example that you gave of the film, there's a projector, there's a film, and then there's a screen. So what you see on the screen is a projection of the film.
Yes,
light
very right.
Falling on the film is projected on the screen.
Very right.
Whatever is there on the film will get projected on the screen.
Yes.
So whatever causes that you have laid in the previous bird will get projected as effect in the next bird.
Okay, so that is the connotation we are supposed to take for the projection word.
Yes. What you're saying is mirage or the illusion. No, that's not
the case. Yeah. So that is not the case.
That is Pranthu. Yeah.
Thank you, Swamiji. It's very clear. Pranam, Swami. Pranam.
Jai Sachidanand Bhai. Uttal Bhai.
Jai Sachidanand.
Jai Sachidanand.
Hi, Jay Sachidanand. My question is, I want to understand how to digest insults. So not insults directly, but apne apman kahiye ne te. So with some people, it's the feeling of, the suffering inside is so intense. And what happens is that when they say something or they laugh at me, at the moment I don't do anything other than maybe convey through my body language that I don't like what you're saying, but they don't understand. But then afterwards, it creates a lot of, like, my mind keeps going, I should have said this. Next time, I'm just going to say this. It's so intense. Shuddhatma, Vyavasthit Shakti, nothing stays. And then if I even try to understand the situation later on to see what happened, it's just my... I can't even see like what's happening. My mind just keeps going into, no, how can that person say that? Next time I'm just going to say this. That's where I am, and it creates a lot of suffering for me, really, and I want to understand how to handle that.
There are two ways of handling it. One is being separate. in the sense the one who is being insulted or laughed at is file number one, and I am the Siddhartha separate from it. One other way of handling it is from the Gnan point of view. This is from the Vignan or the experience level, separation experience. Other way of handling it is that whatever insults come, they are beneficial. The Bhagwan said that if you want to erase the pride kashai or the man kashai, then apman or insults are the remedy. When one gets insulted, the pride is what get hurt, and it is going to scratch or diminish the pride kashai, the pride enemy. So from the spiritual point of view, is insults are helpful in eradicating the pride kashai, the man kashai. This is the absolute thing. So this is the understanding you have to cultivate or keep at the back of your mind, and how this is beneficial from the spiritual point of view, it is detrimental from the worldly point of view. That you are being made fun of or you are being ridiculed. So from the worldly point of view, you will feel put down and feel very bad. It's the ego that is being bruised and hurt, you see. So the intellect part of yours, which says next time I will do this or I will say that and all that. Pray to God, pray to Dada and say, Dada, now give me the strength to do appropriate behavior. Mane yathar vyavahar karvani shakti aapo. So by that time, by asking of that strength, you will be able to be assertive, you'll be able to say or share your feelings without hurting the other person. You know, that you'll have to say, oh, you're saying all this, but I don't like it. I don't like it, or whatever way. You'll be able to put across your feelings unemotionally without getting too engrossed, involved. So you will not be hurt in the process, nor will the other person hurt. It's plain conveying of the feelings that you are experiencing.
I see,
without
sir.
Without blowing out. Either we blow out or we are silent. Typically that's what happens.
Yeah,
when so the inner speech starts and the inner suffocation starts.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah, I understand. So the answer is then consoling file number one. Then it is consoling your mind and consoling your intellect by saying, Sheetal, don't worry. You have squared up one debt. They are instruments. They are not actual doers. They are squaring up whatever pap karma you have done. What, where, you don't know, but it is there. So within yourself, you should be thankful for them. Not on the face or by speech, but within yourself. Oh, Sheetal, you have earned a lot today. You have earned 4 insults. Very good, very good. Dada Bhagwan said that if you can digest 300 insults with the help of Gnan, then your fear of insult will go away and maybe no one will even insult you. So if you get, you know, 100 in a month, at various points of time, Dada has said various two or three things. He has given guidelines. If you can digest 100 insults per month, then you win the battle. And the biggest thing that he has said is that when you are able to digest one insult, you will get the stamina or the strength to digest 2 insults. If you are able to digest 2 insults, you will get the strength to digest 4 insults. It will grow like that.
Multiply.
By multiplication. Multiply, no? But digest in the sense with full awareness and the use of this Gnan.
Right.
That, oh, this Sheetal, this is your thing. The other person is innocent. He is only an instrument or a nimit. and it is your hisab or your account that is being cleared.
Yeah, so I guess when this situation happens again and again, it is important to address it and talk to the person, because being silent is also not a way of handling it, right?
So I said there are two ways to handle it. One is from the spiritual or the Gnan point of view, and one is from the worldly view point of view. From the worldly point of view, you can definitely express your feelings and talk to the other person. And for that, and so that you may be able to do so without you getting disturbed or the other person getting hurt, you have to put a filter before you talk to them. And then if you talk in the heat of the moment, you're going to blast out. And it will only create friction, because they may again retaliate, and that will still make matters worse for you.
Right.
So you have to pause. You know, typically they say you should respond and not react. Typically, we jump into a reaction mode, but you have to respond. For that, as I suggested, just pray very briefly to the other, let me do appropriate behavior with them. Yatharthyavar karmani shaktiyapo. And then you can say. And you'll be surprised. If you really do it properly, na, pray to the Bhagwan, pray to the pure soul within the opposite person who has sort of insulted you. And then if you say, your speech will be very smooth. It'll be smooth without any dvesh, you know, without any hurtful feelings or any vengeance or revenge taking. You'll be surprised. It'll just flow smoothly. So and so, you have done this. I've not liked it. You feel very bad about it. Please don't do it next time. It'll just flow. Just sharing of information, good stop. So you will feel light that you have done something. And that is, you have not taken it laying down.
Yes.
Lying down. You will feel light. That is the ego of Sheetal will feel that. The intellect of Sheetal will feel that. This is to soothe and pacify the discharge ego of number one. And having done that, they may say, okay, sorry, whatever. So you will feel you have done what you want to do from the worldly point of view. After that, you have to settle with, talk to Sheetal. Sheetal, good, you have won something. Today, you have got 3 insults. You know, there's a story of Mahatma. There was a lady Mahatma who had come to Dada Bhagwan. And she said that my mother-in-law is a pain in the neck. And she keeps on abusing me, insulting me throughout the day. And I'm really tired and fed up of her, you know. She starts nagging me right from the morning till the end, and I'm just, I don't know what to do. So Dada Bhagwan paused for a moment and said that now this is your account that you have brought with her. So hisab you have brought with her, and you have to square it up.
Mm-hmm.
Now, earlier you square it up in 3 to 6 months, then it will get exhausted. So Dada Bhagwan said, what to do? Dada, how to clear up the account?
Mm-hmm.
Dada said that you must desire, if you really want to clear up the account quickly, you must desire that if you get 100 insults per day, your account will be cleared in 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
You must desire that you must get 100 insults per day. You have brought a quota of insults. You have got a quota of abuses you are going to get. So, make up your mind that you should get 100 insults per day. And then you get cleared up. So the lady was damn happy. And she went home. And then next day morning, the mother-in-law started saying first thing morning, oh, you have not groomed this room. You have left the vessels like this. You have not done this like this. You are like this. You are like that. She merely started counting 1, 2, 3, 4. She was just counting the abuses. She didn't even bother what the abuses were. She was more interested in the abuse numbers. Then at the end of the afternoon, she said, are you only 20? Then by the night, are you only 30? I thought she's abusing me so much. But when I started counting, it's not much, man. It's just 30. Then she would feel bad. Oh, today only 30 insults. Then tomorrow, today 70 and tomorrow's 100. I hope I get 170 insults tomorrow. So she was keen to get insults. She was keen to be abused or, you know,
She's free of fear of insults.
So her whole vision changed.
Yeah.
First thing, that each insult was it's like a hammer in the head, you know. It would hurt her very badly and
yeah.
terrible and miserable and all that. Now, whole vision changed. Oh, good. If I get 100, it's very good. It'll get clearer. So, she was keen and just counting. And rather than intensity and all that is all attention moved away, you know. And she developed, basically in the process, she developed the capacity to take the insults equanimously. And then after some time, it stopped hurting her.
Yeah.
Now, this is the science that the Bhagavan has revealed when he has talked about man, kasha, or pride, you know. That if you want to really eradicate that weakness of pride, then insult is thing. And if you get 100 insults per month, mental quota, I mean, you won't get 100. That means 3 per day, roughly. Then you should feel happy. But what happens is it comes in parts and pieces. So when it comes, we forget because in between there are no insults.
Right.
And if you can handle these up to say 300 insults with the help of Gnan equanimously, that the person is innocent, my account is getting cleared, you know, and you are thankful to the person who is insulting you. Thank you for clearing my debt. You have charged the bad karma for you, but you have cleared me in the process, cleared my debt in the process. So with good feelings for him, that okay, I give blessings to the person who insults me. I have done that throughout my life. All those people who have given, who use not a good language with me, I have accepted them and blessed them. Main ashirwad apine jher pida che. Ane jher pine hun nilkant thayo chu. But taking so much of bitter or poisonous behavior and speech from others, I have become Mahadeva or Nilkant. So that was the roadmap he has gone through and he has shared it for us. So this is how, from the now, to summarize, what you have to do is set this understanding within you that, oh, these insults are useful. They're going to clear my debt. So I am going to be thankful and happy. With that frame of mind and that understanding, you will then go to your workplace. And there we start counting and be happy. And of course, the drama you can do. Drama Sheetal will do anyway. Because it's going to boil up and down. The ego and mind or intellect is going to not remain silent. So then put the filter. Okay, Dada Bhagwan, let me do appropriate behavior. And then voice out your assertive behavior politely or firmly rather. Firmly telling that this is not acceptable to me.
Okay.
Ah, good. Yeah, putting that filter before speaking is really important, and it's okay to speak. There is no need to just take it silently. But that understanding, the vision that this is beneficial to me.
And I've not mentioned one more thing, one very fundamental thing, is that whatever is coming is because of some error or mistake we have done in the past or we are doing in the past, you know. So you can also put, okay, what is that mistake? Let me put an end to that mistake. Otherwise, you know, on one end, mistakes will continue. On the other end, suffering will also continue.
I see. So I have insulted somebody
not necessarily. Yeah, it could be an insult. It could be some other law of nature we may be breaking. The result of it is coming as hurt by way of insult.
Okay.
So you must pray that Dada, please let me know what is my root cause or the root mistake. And I apologize for whatever mistake I may have done in the past.
Okay.
So that is cleansing from the karma angle so that the effect that is coming by way of insults will also diminish. And the handling the things with this way, as I said before. The root cause also we have.
That's right. So you talk about this laws of nature quite a bit. So my request for next time, I guess, would be that maybe we can talk about some general laws of nature that are often broken and can cause suffering. Or is that all covered by Navkalamo?
No, Navkalam generally does that. Navkalam is one of them. Generally covered up. There are one or two here and there.
We'll take up next time.
Next time.
We have limited time, three questions. Gandhi.
Yeah, we have three questions. Okay, fine.
Yeah. Umesh Bhai?
Okay, thank you. Swamiji, there are two things. One, in one of the statements to earlier Mahatmas, when you were talking just now, you said Shuddh Upyog is pure awareness state. Is it correct understanding on my part?
Yes.
Okay. Second, a sudden paradigm shift has happened in me when you were saying, when you were explaining projection in terms of cause and effect connotation. So I was just thinking since that time that other than in a magic, in a magician's magic show or something, other than that, there is no illusion in the whole of universe. There's always a cause and effect. Even if we go to Norway or Finland or something and we see the northern lights, that there is a cause and effect relationship there also. So there is no illusion in the universe. Am I correct?
Illusion in the sense, you see, now that depends how you take it. People say there is happiness, this is my brother, my wife, my children. So that is an illusion. No one is really your wife and children. They are only a temporary karmic adjustments of executing your happiness or sorrow.
No, but I am considering them as my brother or sister because of some past karmic configuration or causes. Am I correct? Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. I'm just checking.
That way people say, ye dunya maya hai. This world is an illusion. It's said from that point of view. So what you believe as yours
exactly
is not really yours. Your brother, your sister, your...
Very right, very right.
That point of view, the world is illusionary.
That way the world is illusionary. Thank you. Thank you, Swamiji. It is very clear now, very clear. Thank you so much.
Kashyap Bhai?
Yes, Deepakananji, one poster I have sent you, it is saying, Hamesha je marnar che te dungar je che banati. Please explain this.
Hamesha je marnar che te
dungar je che Bana Nathi. Can you please bring? Didn't come. Hamesha je marna che te dungar ja che. Dungar che.
What is the last word you said? Bhanati.
Bhanati.
Nandi can't. You just put on the screen.
I can't see it.
Why is it not visible?
No, it didn't come.
Visible. It's not visible on dark black screen.
It's not coming? How is
it? Yes, started screen sharing, it says, but.
Somewhere, something else is sharing.
Try again.
No?
No. Picture, no.
Still, it's not coming?
No. Picture is not coming.
Okay.
Manesam, can you tell me what it is? I'm not able to catch that words. You know?
Okay. If you allow me, I will share.
Can you see?
No, Deepak Gandhi.
Can you see on my screen now?
No.
Pulinandi?
Oh, no.
Check my photo.
Your photo, but after photo is not coming.
Turn.
Now, side by side speaker. Okay, I can see my photo. You can see your photo.
Your screen sharing is coming black.
Yeah. Okay, we can see. Hamesha je marnar uchu karo to. Hamesha je marnar che te dungar che ban nathi. The person who hits you is like a mountain, but they do not have ban nathi.
Ban nathi.
They are not doing something consciously.
they are not doing something consciously. Ha, in a bhan nati, okay, he's not conscious of what he is doing. Okay. Yeah. Ah, okay. So one who is hurting, one who is hurting somebody else, he's not aware of what he is doing.
Okay.
That is, he's not aware of the consequences of what will happen of what he is doing. By hurting others, he's going to create hurt or misery for himself. He's not aware of the consequences. That is what he's trying to say. And Dungarche, yaniki, he's very rigid or there is an obstruction in his understanding because of which he's doing the wrong things. We can take it that way.
He's not aware that, fully aware what he's doing and the consequences of what he's doing. Thank you.
Jai Sachin. Thank you. Okay, last question. We'll give you 5 minutes, you know?
Yeah.
Jai Sachidan Pulinanji. I wanted to ask, like, while you were conversing with Sheetal Didi, a question struck me that in contrast to insults, what happens, there are sometimes lots of praises also coming our way. And the effect of insults is then overshadowed by, so the memory just keeps counting the number of praises coming and the insults are kind of, it loses its impact. So even that is very unhealthy. So then how to take the praises also in a very equilibrium manner, like how to deal with them? And that was my question.
Praises and insults are two sides of the coin. Basically, one hurts the ego and one inflates ego feels happy about it. So praises also, we have to take it in the same light that this is the praise that you're getting, Jinal, is the result of your good karma or punya.
Correct.
And the person who is praising you or appreciating you is only an instrument or nimit. Because you have done the same work. If your good karma or punya is not into force, then you would have not got this praise or appreciation. Although you have done good work. But that you are getting this appreciation is a result of your punya karma. The effect is that you feel happy. The ego feels nice. So you have to take it from that perspective. Jinnah, this is the result of your punya. Some good thing you have done, and the other person is mirroring an instrument in executing that. So just take it in a superfluous manner and not get engrossed into it. And because the moment we get engrossed into an appreciation or a praise, we'll develop a rag or liking for the person. So that is the danger over there. And moment he does not, and next time if he doesn't appreciate or praise, then we feel very bad. This man is not talking with spoil like this. And whatever good or good vibes or good feeling you have developed for the person, that will vanish away. You feel, what a great person. Then you feel, no, he's not a great person. Why? Because he stopped appreciation. So appreciation also is a part of a karma given to Jinnal. Observe it. Jinnal feeling good, observe it and leave it at that.
Okay.
So that is the
what happens? She feels guilty for that also, and then she tries to like tell the other person, no, don't praise me. I did nothing like that. But internally it has been accepted, and externally she tries to show that no, I don't want to. I want to be humble. I don't want to all that. She goes away from attention also. That is a very
you can be humble, you can be modest, and you can say politely, oh, God's grace or whatever, depending on who the person is. And just say, God's grace, your luck, I was going to be just helpful. And just leave it at that. So that you are not saying. And if Jinnal feels good, observe that Jinnal is feeling good, but do not take it too much. Do not get habituated to praise.
Okay.
Jinnal is feeling good, observe that also. Science says, observe what's happening. So do not get habituated. Otherwise, you will develop a liking for that person, and then that is going to be a problem.
Yeah, that doesn't happen generally, but
Man khao pan mani
tev na padvi joye. So, what?
Man khao, man chako, pan mani tev na padvi joye. You may get appreciation, but you should not get habituated and develop a liking to get more and more. Then that is detrimental.
Okay. So if we experience that pleasure from man, that is okay, but we should not become habituated. And also, is there a rule, like, for example, 300 insults and then you overcome that? So is there something that if you digest these many praises, then you will become vitraga? Is there like certain rule, or every time you need to?
Well, one of the things that the Bhagavan has said regarding that is that one who has got too much of praise, na, after some time, he will get saturated. He will feel okay. Then he will, his desire or his appetite for praise will diminish or reduce drastically. After that time, he will not even seek for it, or he will not have developed any liking for it.
But there are so many areas of getting praise. Like, for example, if someone praises about my cooking, it's something new for me. If someone praises about my dance, then I've got praises lots of times in that area. So that doesn't affect me. But then there are so many different areas. And then if you get a praise in an area which you were just trying and new, and then it again inflates. So
our overall global vision, that these all praises are part of discharge karma, na? That you're able to do. So whatever good cooking or good dancing you have done, that was part of your favorable, your good karma, that you could do it, and that you had yashnam karma, so people appreciate and give you praises. So just look it from that perspective. Good karma, result has come, leave it at that. Simple.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Namo loye sava saunam.
Eso panchana mukkaro.
Eso panchana mukkaro.
Sauva bhava panasano.
Sauva bhava panasano.
Manglanam cha savesi.
Manglanam cha savesi.
Padamam havai mangalam.
Padamam havai mangalam.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namah shivaya.
Om Namah Shivaya.
Jai Satchidananda.
Jai Satchidananda.
Jai Satchidananda.
Jai Satchidananda. Jai Satchidananda. Thank you for joining English Satsang, and please persuade your friend, family, relatives to join the Satsang and take advantage. Also, after this, we have